So we're going to start with Tamanna, who's one of our students in India, and she's going to take the first few minutes just to tell us a little bit about herself, connected to the theme, and also something about the program she's on, the training program she's on. So over to you, Tamanna.
Thank you, Farhad. I hope I'm audible and clear.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you. Well, I'm Tamanna Edwards. I'm currently in my first year of the qualifying year of the group analysis training in India. When Farhad broached the subject of the introduction for the present talk, I quickly responded with, "But I don't know any technical details about climate change," quite conveniently forgetting that climate change has shaped my life experiences over time. I'd swiftly rush to the theory, leaving the feeling behind. It is something that the course has brought me back to again and again, the person, not just the theory. And that is what I shall be speaking of today, my experiences of climate. I completed my undergraduate degree from Delhi University. I remember staying in a hostel there during uni, where there were only air coolers, not air conditioners. We would incessantly complain about the heat, but that heat felt bearable. After graduating, when I left Delhi, I returned after 8 long years. I couldn't recognize the Delhi that I had left behind. The summers felt more cruel, as if sucking the energy and motivation out of me. And the newspapers reported similar headlines that trumped number after number. Hottest it's ever been, the heat reaches new heights, etc., etc. What was the value we crossed? 46, 48, 50 degrees Celsius? I can't keep track of the numbers, but I do remember the jokes that too increased in their intensity. I'm melting in this heat now became, the heat has made me realize I can't survive in hell, so now I have to change. Melting heat became hell. I laughed at these jokes at the moment, but I do know that the humor hid beneath it, the fear, helplessness, and the scary question, do we have the capacity to handle what will happen ahead? A 2023 study by Dr. Chan echoed my concerns, as India was listed at the top amongst China, Japan, and the US in terms of vulnerability to climate change impacts and lack of readiness to adapt. And while these summers were overstaying, the winters were finished before they even started. Where were these winters, the time where I could soak in the sun and feel its warmth? Now they were much shorter, and I could only feel its burn. A 2018 paper by Paler on psychological well-being in India impacted by climate variability resonated these thoughts, that there has been a gradual change of higher and warmer temperatures in India. The rise of heat has been associated with increase in aggression. No hiding that Delhi, famous for its history, food, and open spaces, is also infamous for road rage and the aggression that it brings out in individuals. But I also realized that as the summer extended and as the heat increased, so did my air conditioner usage, and how quickly that usage moved to exploiting resources that further fed into the climate crisis. The privilege I had to utilize these resources were also quite evident, something that others might not have. A 2018 study by Sanava stated that the effects of climate change had a significantly higher impact among individuals in rural areas where resources were scarce. But climate change is not just about change in weather. It's also the climate anxiety that I witness and mold in my psychotherapy practice, and it is also my body. When I moved to Delhi after 8 years, my body took a lot of time to accommodate. For the first 6 months, I fell sick thrice, alarming for someone who doesn't fall sick that often, and it was the same concerns again and again: cold, a bad throat, coughing, and chest congestion. I realized that it was normalized, as I heard it from others too. It's just the pollution. It happened to me too. We'll get used to it. And well, I did. My body got acclimatized, but I wondered whether I wanted to get used to this. While I can think of many such instances and I'm aware of the socio-economic and psychological impact of climate, I sometimes get caught in the distance between me and climate change. At certain points of time, the climate crisis feels so pressing, so close, so scary. Yet at other times, it feels like a slow humming in the background, as if at times I can keep myself away from the crisis and sit back, hoping that it won't happen. This distance helps to keep the scary emotions at bay, to act as sunglasses while staring at the sun. But it is also an illusion, because when I look closer, I realize that climate change has not only shaped my life experiences, but from the weather to the pollution to the food I consume, it is a part of my living reality. And in recognizing my story and experiences, I drive that part of me that might feel terrified of the future, but in the present can utilize its voice to change that dreaded future.
Are you done?
Okay.
Thank you very much, Tamanna. Thank you. I'm now going to just pin Paul to my screen. And I'd like to now invite Paul Hoggett, who many of you know. I thought I would just start with that picture which came with the publicity for this talk, which is Paul sitting down holding a placard saying, "Jurors, you have an absolute right to acquit a defendant according to your conscience." And this is all to do with judges not allowing protesters to explain why they were protesting in court. And one person who held up that placard got arrested herself. It's also a way of saying that Paul, who's not only an academic psychotherapist, but he also is an activist. And his book that I just can't find right now, his book, which I've started to read, I have to tell you, is actually amazing. The number of times I've said wow in the first 30 pages is... I really recommend it to you. So over to you, Paul.
Wow, thank you, Bad, for that introduction. And Tamanna, thank you very much for your giving us something of the visceral nature of what climate change means in India. I was on the phone this morning to my daughter who lives and works in Cambodia. She's been there for 12 years. And she was saying that there's a pall of smoke all over the village where she lives at the present moment in time because the jungles in the mountains nearby are on fire. And of course, in a place like Cambodia, there are no public services to come out and put the flames out. You just wait for it to go away. And the heat there is over 40 degrees. This book that I had mentioned, which has just come out, I'll maybe give you a link to it that you can go to during the session, because I've deliberately gone with a publisher who are novel in their approach, because they're about getting publish work out to as wide as possible an audience, particularly activist audience, rather than accumulating royalties for publishers and so on and so forth. And so the book's available, particularly the ebook, which I'd heartily recommend because it's got lovely colour pictures in it, whereas a paperback doesn't. It's got black and white pictures. But the ebook is available free. Okay, so all you have to do, Fahad will maybe send you the link. You just click on the link, takes you into their website, and you can get the book for free. And it's under a Creative Commons license, and it's meant to be distributed rather than hoarded, so to speak. The book is the outcome of 15 years' involvement in the development of this area, which has now become known as climate psychology. When I first got involved with this, through the promptings of a colleague of mine, Adrian Tate, who was a climate activist on the Somerset Levels at the time. And it brings together all the workshops and so on that I've been involved in around this issue, and draws on some of the theory and practice of climate change, some of which you might know, things like climate cafes, which are now quite widespread in different parts of the country, both and inside institutions, being used as a kind of a way of enabling people to find a space in which to contain some of their anxieties and other feelings about climate change. But what I want to talk about today is one of the key things for me, which has come out of this experience, which is a kind of a rethinking of what we mean by the self, or if you like, what Tamanna referred to as our internal climate, because I feel in many ways it is our internal climate which has been responsible for the mess that we are now in. So climate psychology, in that sense, seeks to place the citizens of the West under critical scrutiny, because it's the West, it's the global North, which is overwhelmingly responsible for the problems that we now face relating to the climate crisis. And yet, certainly for many decades to come, it will be the least affected. So climate psychology wants to interrogate this self that is complicit in this process. So it tries to throw light upon our complicity and inaction in the face of the climate crisis, and promote a greater ethical and political engagement with the issue. Now, it's only recently that I began to realize, working with some of my colleagues around a book that we produced a couple of years ago for Carnac called Climate Psychology, A Matter of Life and Death. And in those discussions with Wendy Holway and Sally Weintraub and Chris Robertson, it became increasingly clear to me that the self, as I'd unproblematically come to know it, was actually a product of modernity, of Western modernity itself. Yeah. In other words, you could almost say a recent invention rather than some kind of universal of the human condition. And one of the things I feel that's crucial to understand about this self is something, but there's a paradox about it. It's as if through modernity, through the development of capitalism, the Western individual became freed of need. But as soon as that individual became freed of need, they became trapped by longing. And in particular, a longing to be freed of longing. And what is this longing? I think, and this is about the name of my book, Paradise Lost, question mark. I think this longing is partly to do with an unconscious longing for paradise, to be in a kind of ideal world where there is no lack, no sense of loss, no sense of time. And it's this self, this longing for this, that I think is crucial in understanding where we are. I think there are three fundamental separations which therefore underlie this creation of the modern self, this thing we call the modern self. Those three separations are these. We're separated from external nature. The self is separated from its own physical, mortal nature. And the self is separated from other selves. And I'll talk about each of what those in turn. Now, the first of these separations from nature is the one that many of you involved in environmental or climate politics will be most familiar with. It's the way in which we construe nature either as an object to be harnessed and exploited, or as a dump for our waste. and its roots, I believe, can be traced back to a Judeo-Christian God, which, according to Genesis, granted mankind dominion over, quotes, every creeping thing that creepeth upon the earth. The outcome of this estrangement is there for us all to see, and I'm sure I don't need to repeat many of the facts of the climate crisis. You'll be familiar with it, but just a few headline items. The UN framework on climate change 2 years ago suggested that given all the present commitments that have been made by world governments, even if those commitments are fulfilled, the world is on course for 2.7 degrees Celsius global heating. 2.7. Don't think about 1.5. We're already way past that. 2.7. 2.7 is equivalent to the end of the period of the Holocene, which has been around on the Earth for 11,000 years. And it's this period in the Earth's history in which the benign climatic conditions have existed, which have allowed civilizations to be created and to flourish. In other words, we are now exiting the period in which civilization can be sustained into what is increasingly called the Anthropocene. Scientists increasingly now talk about the sixth mass extinction event. Okay, a mass extinction event is where more than 75% of all species on Earth rapidly, in terms of geological time, disappear. The difference this time with this sixth mass extinction event is that it is caused by us, by one species. Finally, the implications are huge for us. Not only does civilization itself become threatened by the end of the Holocene, but actually parts of the world are already becoming uninhabitable, particularly parts of Central America and the African Sahel. And the consequences for social conflict, collapsed states, mass migration are already being experienced, and as I'll talk about later, are leading, I think, to a particular form of authoritarian nationalism called the politics of the armed lifeboat. So returning to this first separation, I think unsurprisingly, this idea that humans were an exceptional species was implicit in much of Enlightenment thought. And to this day, the idea of nature as a subject rather than object, a subject which thinks, feels, and communicates, remains marginal for the Western mind. Okay, the second great separation forming the modern self, I think, is less familiar, certainly to the environmental and climate movement. And it's the idea that we ourselves are of nature. We are creatures, that we have bodies which feel pain and can break down at any moment. In other words, the idea of our physical vulnerability, frailty, and mortality, this idea remains shocking to the modern self. I think that's partly why the COVID pandemic was such a psychological calamity for so many. Suddenly, the idea of mortality and vulnerability was no longer some abstract philosophical idea, but it was an existential reality. And secondly, I think this sense of this refusal to acknowledge vulnerability has a gendered dimension. Hardness and toughness and invulnerability, I think, has a particular sense. There is a particular sense of the masculine associated with it in Western cultures. In my work as a psychotherapist, what I've been struck by is that this separation from our creaturely nature is not typically manifest in an overt terror of mortality in the consulting room. Though it manifests indirectly, I think, sometimes in states like hypochondria. Rather, the way in which it manifests itself primarily is through a deep anxiety about time, and particularly the passing of time. There's an American psychoanalyst called, I think he's named Anthony Smith, who has this phrase, time is mortality's henchman. Time means loss. Time is the ultimate limit that confronts us. Time means money. And in its effort to conquer time, modern life constantly speeds up. Pace of innovation, the bombardment of new fashions, the mania of social media, and some sociologists have coined the term accelerationism to refer to the constant process by which modern Western capitalist societies speed up. For some people, the idea of a world carrying on after they have gone is either incomprehensible or enraging, or both. And it can unleash the most terrible envy towards life itself. You're familiar with COP, the meetings of the great and the good to try and organize global policy frameworks for climate change. As COP follows COP and the climate emergency deepens, one cannot but help wonder whether there isn't something of a kind of nihilism in the air, one linked to survivalism. It's not that survivalists fear a coming catastrophe. The point is, they're already living this catastrophe. The end times have already arrived, and conspiracy theories which reveal the secrets of the times proliferate. I believe that there is a great disturbance afoot. People are aware of the climate crisis and the catastrophe that it is generating, but at the same time, turning away from what they know. And it's causing a huge kind of psychological disturbance manifest in all sorts of ways. Today, survivalism can assume so many different kinds of forms. It can be religious or secular, high-tech or low-tech. It can involve an imagined escape to the hills, to New Zealand, to Mars, to heaven, or to retreat inside the self. Some of you will be aware of some of these forms of survivalism that are proliferating. Take one example. Christian evangelism in North America, which now plays an increasingly powerful role in Trump's attempts to become a successful president for the second time. Very interesting to look at the position of the evangelical right in America on what's happening in Gaza. Yeah. Because they see the struggle of Palestinians and the conflict in Gaza very much through the prism of their apocalyptic fantasy of the second coming. And the coming Armageddon. For them, bring it on, as far as they're concerned. This is what prophecy foretells. Take the issue of high-tech survivalism. There, some of you are familiar with the whole concept of transhumanism, which is the attempt by many, particularly linked with Silicon Valley, to find ways of escaping the possibility of their own physical vulnerability and mortality by upgrading their brains, for example, in computer software. Ray Kurzweil, who used to work for Google, has been trying to do this for some time. If you look at transhumanism and go to some of their websites, there are some extraordinary discussions and developments in terms of the attempts to escape, if you like, our mortal coil altogether. So survivalism can assume so many forms, and it is all over the place at the present moment in time. What then are the third great separation? That is the separation from other selves. We tend to think of this in terms of the competitive individualism of neoliberal society. You'll remember, those of you from the UK, Margaret Thatcher's great phrase, "There is no such thing as society, only individuals and their families." For Thatcher, morality was an entirely individual and private affair. But when this individualism, which has been so pronounced over the last 50 years, merges with human exceptionalism, the result, and a number of analysts have talked about this, a number of psychoanalysts, the result can be a veritable allergy to other minds, manifest both in narcissistic individuals and, more stridently, in the life of groups. Whilst for some the existence of different minds comes simply as a surprise, "Gosh, you mean my partner doesn't think in the same way that I do?" For others, such differences are deeply threatening, as if the existence of difference itself threatens the very existence of self. And in this state of mind, being in the right takes on existential significance. You'll remember, many of you, Freud, when he spoke of the life of groups, spoke of what he called the narcissism of minor differences. His point was that for the narcissistic state of mind, there is no such thing as a minor difference. All differences are major. These then are the three great separations which I think underlie the modern self. And it's vital that we know what we're up against, for the survivalist and the narcissist lurks within all of us. When we set up the Climate Psychology Alliance in 2012, our strapline was facing difficult truths. It's no easy task for citizens of the West to face up to the climate crisis. Whilst there are still some in outright denial of climate change, most of us tend to deploy what's called soft denial. In our minds, we split off facts and information from meaning and feeling. In this way, our thoughts become less troublesome, less likely to prompt us to engage with the issue in any meaningful way. But as the facts accumulate and our defenses begin to break down, then things change. And I think 2018 was the year when this really started to happen, manifested in a wave of what the media called eco-anxiety. In the Climate Psychology Alliance, we prefer to call this eco-distress, but it really, I believe, refers to two quite different reactions. The survivalist in us feels terror at the prospect of calamity and an overwhelming concern for the security of self and one's loved ones. Fear fuels fantasies of escape and retreat. The ultimate political expression of this is the authoritarianism now resurgent all around us. Like preppers, but on a national scale or even a European scale, we secure our borders and our reserves of food and energy. This is the politics of the armed lifeboat, as it's become known. But climate distress can lead to an altogether different reaction. Rather than fear and panic, the self experiences loss, grief, and remorse for that loss and anger at the causes of that loss. These moral anxieties provide the condition for real ethical and political engagement, one which is capable of transcending all that separates us. This reaction grounds itself upon a recognition of our inextricable dependency, both upon nature, our own bodily nature, and upon others. This ethics of individual humility is the antithesis to the exceptionalism of the modern self. Now, I'm going to stop there, and I think we're going to have a break it up for a while and have some time for discussion in small groups. And then later, I want to talk a bit more about what I've called this ethics of individual humility. And in particular, talk a little bit about the opposite of the other side of mortality, which is natality, a concept from a political philosopher called Hannah Arendt, and the links between natality, vitality, and hope. But for now, let's pause.
So back to you, Paul.
Okay. Thank you for her. So far, so bad. Yeah. This is all a bit depressing. I think there's a growing interest at the moment in the idea of a post-tragic perspective. So what I've given you is a tragic perspective, yeah, so far. And I think it's one that's pretty compatible with one powerful strand within psychoanalytic and philosophical thinking, which is very stoical. Yeah, it says, you know, life's a bit of a mess. We're fallible, frail human beings, mortal creatures. We suffer injustices, et cetera, and we need to find inner strength to be able to manage ourselves in a world that we should have no illusions about can be a very difficult world, full of irreconcilable conflicts, moral dilemmas, and so on and so forth. And what I've described clearly, in a way, what we're facing is a kind of tragedy as well in terms of climate change and the destructive impacts that it's already having. And it's a difficult truth that we have to be able to help, be helped to face. But I think we need also to be able to go beyond that kind of tragic appreciation of the tragic situation that psychoanalysis has been very helpful in providing us with some of the resources, ways of thinking to do that. And I think we need to begin to develop what some people are now referring to as a post-tragic perspective. Yeah. And for me, this is about beginning to think of the foundations for hope and vitality and creativity, and that are part of both everyday life and political movements. And I just want to start by reading something from the great anthropologist and environmentalist Joanna Macy. She wrote a book, some of you might well know of it, which was a book of the poems of Rainer Maria Rilke. And the book is called In Praise of Mortality. And towards the end of her introduction to Rilke's poetry, she says this, and she refers to some of his most famous sonnets and poems. What gives the Duino elegies and sonnets to Orpheus their visceral potency is Rilke's determination to cherish life in direct confrontation with what robs us of life. In the face of impermanence and death, it takes courage to love the things of this world and to believe that praising them is the noblest calling. Rilke's is not a conditional courage dependent on an afterlife, nor is it a stoic courage keeping a stiff upper lip when shattered by loss. It is a courage born of the ever unexpected discovery that acceptance of mortality yields an expansion of being. In naming what is doomed to disappear, naming the way it keeps streaming through our hands, we can hear the song that this streaming makes. Our view of reality shifts from noun to verb, and we become part of the dance. And I think there's something there that Joanna Macy captures, which is something beyond the stoical and the tragic. And I've found that for me, the idea of natality is crucial in beginning to open up this kind of way of thinking and feeling. And the idea of natality comes from Hannah Arendt, who's many of you may be familiar with some of her most famous books. One was called On Totalitarianism, and the other was Eichmann in Jerusalem. But she also wrote a book called The Human Condition, on the human condition, in which she develops this idea of natality. And natality, in that sense, what she's saying is there is no mortality without natality, no ceasing to be without at the same moment something coming to be. And she sees natality as the basis of the unexpected, the unanticipable. She says, if there is one thing to be anticipated and expected of human beings, is that they will always come up with the unexpected and the unanticipatable. And that notion of natality, new beginnings, clearly connects to the idea of new life, new birth, yeah, and the idea of new beginnings. Now, when we think about hope, we often think about hope as something which is as something quite fragile and insecure. And indeed, I found that very often I find that people sort of cling to hope almost in a kind of defensive sort of way. I've run workshops over a long period of time with local groups around the theme of how do you talk about climate change with friends, family, neighbours and colleagues at work. And one of the key ideas that we've developed in those workshops is if you go in to those conversations with the hope of changing the mind of the person that you're engaging with, you're on a hiding to nothing. Yeah, it won't work because you're, if you like, you're not going into the conversation with an attitude of curiosity and openness. You're going in there as a defensive reaction to your own anxiety about hopelessness. Yeah. You're going in with an outcome in mind. And it's one of the key ideas also shared by many in Extinction Rebellion. You suspend your need to have an outcome in mind when you engage in these kinds of actions. So hope can be a defensive reaction against despair. There's also, I think, a lot to be said for the fact that very often people, strangely enough, cling to despair because of the certainty that it actually brings. And that's particularly true in politics. So strangely enough, the certainty of despair can be preferred to the precarity of hope. I sometimes feel now that it's quite important to encourage people in the practice of being hopeless, you know, being in that sense without hope. And I think there's a great deal to be said for the practice of being hopeless in that kind, because I think it takes us to a different kind of hope. And in particular, the idea of hope as a state of expectant possibility takes us back to Arendt and this idea of natality. Some of you might be familiar with the psychoanalyst Alessandra Lemma, who in London worked for a long time, many years, with refugees, many of whom were traumatised by their experiences in war-torn countries and civil wars. And she came up with this thought of what she called mature hope, which she described as this state of expectant possibility. And I quite liked that, because there is something there in the notion of expectancy which took my mind to the idea of expecting. She's expecting, we say, when someone is pregnant. Yeah, she's expecting. So there's something there about the possible. Yeah. And then my mind was taken, obviously, to psychoanalyst called D.W. Winnicott, who had this idea of potential space. Yeah. The space in which something new might happen. Yeah. And so I think these provide us with maybe a more enduring foundation for what we call hope. And it's quite interesting that just before the COP26 in Glasgow, there was a gathering of Extinction Rebellion supporters in London, which actually used this idea of gestation, yeah, as a way of trying to develop a new kind of social imaginary, a new way of thinking, new ways of thinking relating both to action and to the way in which we engage with each other, the forms of solidarity that we have with each other. So, new beginnings, new possibilities, potential space, gestation. And then I suppose I was drawn to thinking about the role of what is the process by which in psychotherapy or in groups we work, and how important gestation is to that process by which a psychotherapist works, a kind of holding back, not moving in too quickly, a kind of abstinence, kind of surrender almost to the thoughts and feelings of the person that you're involved in the consulting room. And in particular, maybe being in a certain sort of way, allowing oneself to be moved by the other. And putting that together with thinking about gestation, what also began to occur to me was the importance of what we might call vitality. Yeah. And I was thinking, it's in the book that I've written, how important the idea of vitality is, both in music, which I have an absolute passion for, but also in terms of looking at the development of my own children and the way in which I related to my own children, particularly when they are young. I have a grandson at the moment, arrives half past seven every Tuesday morning, bursts in the door and just knocks us over with his vitality. Yeah. So I thought, well, it'd be interesting to see what psychoanalysis has to say about vitality. And so I went to the psychoanalytic electronic publishing website to see what kind of articles have been written about vitality. And do you know, the interesting thing is, although the word came up over 4,700 times in different articles, there was just one book which was actually formally about the issue of vitality. And that was a book written by Daniel Stern just before he died in 2012. Stern being an analyst who worked extensively with mothers and children and was developing those kind of infant observation techniques that so many people have used in their own trainings. And he wrote a book called Forms of Vitality, which is a fascinating book to read because he's talking about the power of movement and the importance of movement in vitality. Yeah, really interesting. And at first I couldn't figure it. And then I began to think, yes, movement is so much about being moved in the context of the work that we do as psychotherapists and our capacity to allow ourselves to be moved. And then I thought about politics and how crucial the idea of movement is in politics. We talk of political and social movements, yeah? And therefore the concept of movement is not some kind of slightly strange and alien thing, which is just about physical bodies. The idea of movement is central to both our thinking about the human psyche and to our thinking about society. And then finally, I came across the work, the most recent book of Amitav Ghosh. Many of you will have come across him. But his latest book talks about a vitalist politics. Yeah, a politics which is drawing on some of these forms of improvisation, creativity, the sheer joy, in a way, of action that a young toddler kind of shows through their everyday reactions. So I'm going to stop at that point, and maybe we can talk more about hope and vitality and so on after another opportunity to just talk together in our groups.
I'm sorry to say that we're at the end of our time. It feels like we've only just started. So I just want to say, Paula, I think firstly to say thank you. I really recommend your book to others because it's not just about climate change. It is about the human condition. You bring in a lot of different things from capitalism, neoliberalism, modernity, psychoanalysis, philosophy. I think it's a deep book. So anyway, and you're giving it away free, so you are walking the talk. No, really, I think that's such a important thing. I actually have a physical copy of it, but if you send me that link, I will distribute it. But thank you very much, Paul, for this talk from you. Really appreciate it. Thank you.
And thanks, Paul.
Dil se tujhko bedili hai, mujhko hai dil ka guru, tu ye maane ke